Hi, I'm Dr. John Kugler with the Stanford 25 Ultrasound Series. Today we're going to be learning about lung ultrasound. Now, lung ultrasound is really important, especially in my practice as a hospitalist. I use lung ultrasound all the time to evaluate patients for various conditions. Today I want to focus on pneumothorax, pleural effusions, as well as telling the difference between A lines and B lines, which will help us to better understand if a patient might have a pulmonary edema or a pneumonia. To get started, we'll start with pneumothorax. Now, as a hospitalist, I don't diagnose a lot of pneumothoraces, right? My colleagues down in the ED are usually checking this out more than I am. But it can be useful, especially after performing a procedure where pneumothorax is possible. Now, using ultrasound to look for pneumothorax is really nice because it's quick and it has a very, very high negative predictive value. If I perform this scan, I can say with confidence that my patient doesn't have a pneumothorax. The sensitivity of this scan is such that when you perform it, you well outperform a chest x-ray, and you approach a CT scan in terms of the negative predictive value, which is why so many of us like doing the scan this way. Now, to get started, we're going to position our patient, and then we're going to grab a probe. I'm going to show you all today using a linear probe, though to be honest with you, you could do this scan with many different probes and it works. But we'll be able to see the best today with linear probes, so I like to show you with this. When we position our patient, we'll usually have the patient lying flat, okay? We can have the bed up maybe a little bit, like here we have a pillow under his head, but it's really important because air is going to rise, and we want to put the probe where the air would go, right? If we have the patient sitting straight up, the air is going to come up here to the clavicles, and we actually can't see very well the sliding that we need to see up here above the clavicles. So what we need to do is scan with the patient lying flat. I'm going to place the probe across a couple of rib spaces here, and this is about the highest part of the chest here, so this is where the air should go. And if we go, we can see here, I've got a beautiful picture of two ribs and the space right in between. All right, I'm going to look for that bright white line. That bright white line is the interface between the visceral and parietal pleura. If I see movement along that bright white line, I sometimes call it ants on a log. You see these little things kind of moving back and forth, right? So long as your patient's breathing, you'll see that movement, all right? That lets you know that there's no pneumothorax. What happens is if there is a pneumothorax, air will come in between the visceral and parietal pleura, and it won't let you see that movement any longer. So if you don't see any movement between that rib space, you need to stop and think you might be dealing with a pneumothorax here. But as long as I see movement, as I do today, I can feel confident my patient doesn't have a pneumothorax. So our patient today did not have a pneumothorax. But let's go ahead and take a look at a video of what a pneumothorax would look like if our patient had one. So here again, we can see that spot in between the two ribs and the bright white line. Okay, again, that should be your pleural interface. Now before, we saw that sliding. We saw it looked like there were little ants moving back and forth along that white line. But here in this video, there's nothing, right? And the reason for that is we're really only seeing the parietal pleura, and there's air between the parietal pleura and the visceral pleura, all right? Or at least that's our assumption. Now, there are a few things that can cause an absence of lung sliding, and it's important that you know that. So we do know that the positive predictive value of lack of lung sliding isn't nearly as good as the negative predictive value of seeing it. So if we go ahead and look and we don't see lung sliding, you cannot assume that you found a pneumothorax. You either need to do additional studies to try to figure this out. So what I want all of you to be good at, though, is can you identify a lack of lung sliding to know that it's time to do additional studies? And here in this video, we can clearly see there is no lung sliding at all, and we should be nervous that this patient may have a pneumothorax. Next, we're going to learn about how to look for pleural effusions. This is a scan that I use all the time. Pleural effusions are pretty easy to find with ultrasound, and it's very, very sensitive. You're going to find pleural effusions that you don't see with the chest x-ray, but you can pick up with ultrasound. It's sensitive for very, very small amounts of fluid. So how do we do this? We first need to position our patient. This is where you want to ask your patient to go ahead and take your right arm, we're going to start on the right side, and place it behind your head. We want to be able to expose the entire side of the chest here, including the axilla. Then you can use either a cardiac probe or an abdominal probe, the curvilinear probe, but I prefer the cardiac for this scan. And I'm going to place the probe with the probe indicator, and that's a little different on each on each device. This probe indicator is this little bump here, okay? I want to place that superiorly, headed towards the axilla, and I'm going to place the probe itself somewhere between the mid-axillary and the posterior axillary line. So again, if we look here, this is our mid-axillary line here, this is the posterior axillary line, so right in this space here, and I'm going to be looking through the liver. My goal is to see the liver. Once I find the liver, I'm going to aim my beam up into the chest, right? So here we can see we've got a nice image of the liver. That bright white line, that big curved line there, that's the diaphragm, okay? My goal is to see to the other side of the diaphragm. So what I do is I rock the probe, okay, and because I want to head up farther into the chest. Now, if we watch the screen, we can see the diaphragm moving, okay? Our patient's diaphragm works. That's great. We can also see this sort of scalloped look sort of along the bottom of the screen, okay? The diaphragm kind of merges with that scalloped structure there. What we're actually looking at is our patient's spine at this point, okay? We're seeing all the way to the mid-chest. That's the spine. Now, what we're going to look for is we're going to see, does the spine go past the diaphragm? If the spine goes past the diaphragm, you're looking at an effusion, right? Because remember, on the other side of the diaphragm, you have lungs that are full of air. You can't see through them, right? You wouldn't be able to see past the lungs to see the spine. But in this case, we can see, just as we expect, as soon as we hit the diaphragm, we cannot see the spine anymore. We know that our patient here does not have any effusion on that right side. So we can feel very confident in ruling out a right-sided pleural effusion. Next, we're going to do the left side of the chest. Now, the left side's a little bit more difficult than the right for a couple different reasons. First is our window now, instead of the liver, is going to be the spleen. And as you all know, the spleen is considerably smaller and a bit more variable in terms of the size and the way it's sort of rotated inside the abdomen. And so it's a little harder to find and a little harder to use as a window compared to the liver. Similarly, you also have a stomach bubble here, which can be full of air if the patient's eaten recently. And so that can also be a little bit of a challenge when you're trying to get that crisp, clean image that you want. But don't get frustrated. We're gonna figure this out. So first, let's position our patient. And let's go ahead and have your left hand go behind your head. You can bring your right hand back down. And we're going to put some gel here on our probe. Just like on the right side, we're going to get our probe indicator. Some people call it the dot. This machine is our dot, okay? And when you want to find the spleen, okay, usually you're going to go, you know, somewhere again between mid-axillary and posterior axillary line. Sometimes it's helpful to actually find the kidney and use that to find the spleen. And there I'll go all the way to the posterior axillary. But let's go ahead and place the probe right about here. I'm going to slide around until I find the spleen. Now, again, here we're pretty lucky. We've got a beautiful picture of the spleen. Again, our probe indicator is pointed towards the axilla, all right? And we're pretty happy with our picture. And now we're going to see, can we make it any better? Oh, now it's a little bit better. Now I can see the spine there. I can see the diaphragm. And so I'm pretty happy with this. I feel pretty confident, again, since I don't see the spine continue past the diaphragm, that I've ruled out even a small pleural effusion. I feel pretty good about this image. But sometimes you're not going to be this lucky. The left side can be more difficult. So there will be times where we need to take a different approach. So for this, what I'm going to have our patient do is just go ahead and take a big, deep breath. Let's see what happens here. Keep going. And notice with that big, deep breath, suddenly the whole screen went gray. All right. When that happens, what's occurring inside the body is that his diaphragm now just moved, and now we've got air in between our probe and the spleen. Okay, that made our screen go fuzzy. We've essentially ruled out a large pleural effusion by doing that. We call that the curtain sign. Now, again, could he have a small pleural effusion? Yeah. But again, sometimes when you're evaluating a patient, you can't get that perfect picture. You can use the curtain sign to at least look and make sure that it's not, you know, a large pleural effusion causing shortness of breath. Next, we're going to go ahead and take a look at a video of what a pleural effusion actually looks like. Today, our patient was healthy. He didn't have any pleural effusions. But these are things that you will definitely find in your hospital practice. So it's important that you get to know what you're looking for. So as we talked about before when we were scanning, we're looking right at the base of the diaphragm there to see, does the spine continue past the diaphragm and into the thoracic cage? Normally, again, we can't see that because there's air in the way. But if there's fluid there, that fluid is going to give you a great view of the spine. Now, as soon as you see it go past like that, now you need to explore this effusion a little bit, all right? And so in this video, we can clearly see the spine moving past the diaphragm. And then, especially if we angle the probe a little bit more anterior, we're actually able to see a bit of atelectatic lung, so a little bit of collapsed lung that's floating in that fluid, move in and out of our screen. We have clearly diagnosed a pleural effusion. You can also look around to see, well, are there any septations? Okay, is there layers within the fluid? Is the lung tethered and not able to move, or is it moving around freely as the patient breathes? All of this is going to give you some idea of whether or not this is a free-flowing effusion, or whether it's loculated or even an empyema. Up until now, we've really just looked at the area around the lungs. Now we're going to move into actually examining the lungs themselves, and this is where it's really important that we learn about two different artifacts, A-lines and B-lines. So to do this well, I'm going to show you a video clip here of A-lines and B-lines. We'll start with A-lines. A-lines are considered normal, okay? If you are healthy and well, when I examine your lungs, I should see A-lines. What are they? Well, when I place the probe onto the chest and I look between the ribs and into the lung tissue, what I'll see are repeated horizontal lines here, okay? They start from the pleural interface, and they're actually at repeated, repeating depths below that. And that is an A-line. We think of that as, well, there's normal tissue right below my probe. I'm not seeing deep into the lung, so you really want to be careful. I'm really only able to say right at that interface that there's normal lung tissue there. Could there be something hidden deep that you can't see? Yes. So again, be careful. You have not ruled out any bad pathology there. But you have ruled out pathology right underneath your probe if you see A-lines. Now, occasionally, if your probe is not perpendicular to the pleural interface, you won't be able to see A-lines. And so it does require a little bit of moving the probe back and forth to make them pop out. Next are B-lines. This is the most common pathology that you're going to find when you go ahead and examine the lungs. B-lines, as opposed to horizontal, these are vertical lines. They also start at the pleural interface. Now, for it to be a true B-line, in the lung ultrasound setting, so set at about 13 centimeters, the streak artifact will start at the pleural interface and go all the way to the bottom of the screen. Similarly, it also needs to move as the patient's breathing. So as we look at this video, we can see that it's moving back and forth. It comes and goes, okay? So if they're fixed in place, that's not a B-line. It needs to look like these guys. They move back and forth. Similarly, they can be of different widths. Some can be narrow, some can be large. Again, when we're looking at this video here, we want to get a sense of, well, is that a lot of B-lines? Is that not too many B-lines? And there's two different ways to quantify that. One, you can just count the number of B-lines that you see, okay? The more, the worse it is. Or you can actually see how much of the screen they take up. So B-lines can get quite fat and then can suddenly take up a lot of the screen. When you see that, that also means the pathology is worse. Now we're ready to go ahead and take a look at the lungs themselves. When we do lung ultrasound, there is not one defined way to do this, and that's really important to remember. It depends a little bit on how sick your patient is, right? So if my patient right now is in extremis, he's ready to get intubated because he's so short of breath, I may not need to do that many windows to understand what's wrong with the patient. However, if my patient's completely healthy and I'm looking for very subtle signs of pneumonia, I may need to do a much more thorough scan to really feel like I've ruled that out. And at this point where we are in lung ultrasound is there's many different protocols that are out there in terms of the number of windows you get. And again, for all of you, it might really depend on your clinical setting, how sick your patient is, and that's going to help you to understand, well, how many parts in the lung do I need to look at to feel certain that I've learned enough to make a diagnosis. The other thing I want you to think about is we're all used to thinking about the lungs in terms of chest x-rays, and I still think that's helpful to me. So when I go ahead and scan, I'm almost building a chest x-ray in my head. Where do I see pathology? Is it on the left side? Is it on the right side? Is it diffuse? Do I see it everywhere? Or is it just in a few spots? The way I want you all to think about it is when we find pathology, when we find B-lines, you can think about that as an opacity on chest x-ray. It's clearly a problem area that you're going to need to explore more. How do we go ahead and get these images? I'm going to go ahead and use a cardiac probe here, though again, you could use other probes. For lung ultrasound, it's pretty straightforward. Many of your machines now have a lung ultrasound setting, and that helps. It'll set our depth to the appropriate depth. Again, just by convention, I'm going to have my probe indicator pointed up, okay? And for this, I'm going to go ahead and show you four points on the chest where we're going to look. On the left-hand side, it's actually a little bit harder because we need to avoid the heart. Again, we're going after the lung here. So we'll place the probe where we think we're, at least on this side, above the heart. And here, we can see beautiful A-lines. I can feel really confident, that's normal, right? This is not a technique-heavy scan. I'm just placing the probe, and I'm looking to see what I see, okay? It doesn't require a lot of changing the angles or anything like that. Now, occasionally, if I don't see the A-lines pop out, I might need to adjust a little bit to make sure I'm perpendicular. And now I've got some A-lines, I can move on, okay? I'm gonna come, again, I'm trying to avoid the heart, and so I'll come over here, and again, I'm gonna adjust my angle a little bit, and boom, there are my A-lines, perfect. Now we're gonna come over here and see again, can I get around the heart? Nope, I can't, so I've still got heart here. I'm gonna move over here, and now I'm a little bit below the heart, and we'll see if we can get some A-lines to pop out for us, okay? And there we go. Now, depending on what you're scanning for, you might then go and look for a pleural effusion. You may have the patient sit up, and you may need to now scan all those areas of their back as well, okay? Because again, I've only looked at the left anterior side of the chest. I could also come over here to the right side and take a look over here. Again, and again, I see nice A-lines pop out. Right side's a little easier. I don't have to contend with the heart. So it should be a little bit more straightforward. Again, I'm gonna angle the probe a little bit, and now I get my A-lines. I can feel good that we got a nice view there. I can come down here. Again, easier because there's no heart in the way. I got A-lines, and I would just continue to do this. This would be an 8-point scan where we do four areas of the chest here. We can combine that by looking at the mid-axillary lines. We can look for pleural effusions. And again, if you need to be really thorough, we can sit the patient up and scan their entire back as well. How are we going to interpret this? Okay, and this is where it gets a little bit tricky. The technique is easy. We found A-lines and B-lines, no problem. We're just placing the probe in between the rib spaces. It's gonna be the interpretation that's a little bit more tough, right? Here we need to really use our skills of clinical integration. So let's imagine we're doing our scan and we see a lot of B-lines and it's just over this area of the chest, right? It's just on the left side of the chest. Well, that would be concerning that perhaps the patient has a focal pneumonia there, right? It's certainly something that's not widespread. It's in just one small area. Similar to if you had a chest x-ray and you saw an opacity on the left side, you might say, oh, perhaps this patient has a pneumonia. We still need to use our clinical integration. Does the patient have a fever? Does the patient have a white count? How do their lungs sound? Are they producing sputum? Again, clinical integration here is key. Now, similarly, if I looked and everywhere I placed the probe, right, I see B-lines everywhere. And maybe there's some small pleural effusions on both sides, okay? Well, now I'm thinking, well, this is most likely to be pulmonary edema. It's a diffuse process over both lungs. And again, in the right clinical setting, I should be very, very concerned that perhaps the patient has pulmonary edema. It's gonna be all about the patterns of pathology that you find. Now, the last thing I'll say, especially as someone who works in the hospital, is the key to clinical integration here is that you're gonna have patients who are maybe a little bit sick, maybe a little bit short of breath, and you find a little bit of pathology. The hard part for all of you is gaining enough experience to say, did I see enough pathology there to explain the level of illness that I'm seeing? Okay, my patient's on 4 liters nasal cannula, SATing 96%, and I saw a few B-lines. Is that enough to explain that level of hypoxemia? Perhaps not, okay? And this is where, again, when you're done today with watching this video, you're not ready to answer that question. You're gonna need to get some practice and to do some scanning to start working on your clinical integration so you can feel much more confident that those few B-lines didn't answer your clinical question. You need to look for what else could be going on.